Chancellor. She has led the and has been PI for the Transfer of Transfer projects on Writing Transfer, and we're very excited to have her here with us and to talk to us a little bit more around writing across different contexts and teasing that out a little bit more. Thank you, Catherine.
Students believe that their lives It's a wonderfully accessible book. It includes multiple disciplines. It includes work from the primary sector, the secondary sector, and higher education as well. Some of the observations that the National Research Council makes about transfer have to do with the bullet points before you. First, that prior knowledge shapes learning. It does not determine learning, but it comes so close to determining learning that it's kind of amazing. And it has serious implications for how we ask students, new employees, continuing employees, what their prior knowledge is. Because without asking it, we don't really know what it is, and it's very difficult to speak to it. So the kind of enculturation that we heard about this morning has everything to do with the idea of prior knowledge, because enculturation is supposed to take people's prior knowledge and help them adapt it as they go forward. There are obviously differences between novices and experts. And our job in the academy is to help people develop some expertise. I'm assuming that in the workplace, the idea is to help employees develop more expertise so that they're better in their positions. One of the things that experts can do that novices cannot is that they have a mental map. They have a mental map of the field that allows them to read across information in the field, to read data in the field, to see similarities, to see differences, to raise really good questions. If you think of a map as a large map in print, that's what experts have. What novices have, we theorize, is a GPS. A GPS is very useful in terms of getting you from A to B, but it does not give you a map of the field. And so work on transfer is one thing that we try to do, is help students develop a larger mental map, in this case, of writing. And we know from how people learn that contextualized practice, which is basically a John Deweyan idea of using experience as a way of learning, that contextualized practice is very important. Someone asked me yesterday, or maybe it was the day before, how important reading was in learning to write, a question that actually came up this morning. I think that's a really important question, and I think there's no question it can make a lot of difference. But at the end of the day, if you want to write, you got to write. I mean, there's just no way. It's much like a computer. I mean, if I want to use a computer, I can read about it, I can talk to other people about it, but until I get my fingers on the keyboard, nothing's really happening. So that's what contextualized practice is. Explicitness means, and we've heard again this morning, we've heard about language, we've heard about different kinds of language and so forth. Explicitness basically means we need to be explicit. If you want someone to engage in a particular genre, if you're concerned about errors in the writing, there's a language for that. We need to be explicit about it. That's the way that transfer operates, is through explicitness. And last but not least is reflection. Reflection being metacognition, or the kind of meta-awareness that Anthony referred to, basically means that students are looking at what they've done and as a way not only to understand what they've done, but as a way to move forward. I'll point out, if you're interested in this, I don't know that I put this on this, I didn't put it on the handout, but I'm happy to send you the link. There are a series of research reports that are coming out of the Harvard Business School that ask a very interesting question, and it is a question, again, about enhancing performance and therefore about transfer. And to give you the basic model, they've done studies in the classroom and they've done studies in the field. They were looking at new employees specifically. And the question that they raise in all of these studies is whether or not practice makes perfect or whether practice makes permanent. And what they found is that practice makes much more permanent than it does perfect. And that if you actually want someone to get closer to perfect, you need to build reflection into the model. So very quickly, the two models look like this. There's a lot more to this. I'm simplifying enormously, but it gives you the idea. They would take new employees who are in a six-week new employee training regimen, and they gave one group all the time that they needed to practice, and that's all they did was practice. They gave the other group the same opportunity to practice, but at the end of every day, the new employees were asked to spend 15 minutes identifying key lessons from experience. The new employees who identified the key lessons from experience outperformed the people who did not reflect. So the question is, the way I think of it is as Malcolm Gladwell's, does it take 10,000 hours to learn to become an expert, or is it 9,000 hours of practice and 1,000 hours of reflection? So that's a way of thinking about this. So that's something about it, reflection, how it's valuable. Thinking now about transferring some because we're looking at different contexts, specifically here, school and beyond school. We know that transfer is affected by the degree to which people learn with understanding rather than merely memorizing a set of facts or following a fixed set of procedures. Again, I will point here to a study that was just released having to do with learning in chemistry. Again, they divided students into two different kinds of students. One of whom were very good at identifying procedures and using them almost mindlessly, and another group that they called the rule people, by which they didn't mean rules, they meant learning principles. The students who had learning principles outperformed the other students. Because why? There's a theory there. You have to understand the theory of the practice if you're going to practice well. We know that in a learning context, that appropriate range contrasts can help people notice new features that previously escaped their attention and learn which features are relevant or irrelevant to a particular concept. So it's a principle of at least two. Transfer necessarily involves two contexts. So where we can build in at least two, we have the opportunity for transfer. We will see some examples of this as we go forward. And we know, a theme that we've heard all day long, it takes time. There are also some conditions for transfer. Perkins and Solomon are cognitive psychologists, and these conditions were identified a long time ago. It's not new, it's 1991. Five of them specifically. That if you want people to be able to transfer, to use appropriately in another setting where people have learned in one, they have to have thorough and diverse practice. It can't all be the same. It has to be a range. They need to be able to explicitly abstract from that experience what they learned, sort of the key lessons idea from our business reports. They need to monitor their own learning. That is, they have to be self-aware. They have to pay attention to what they're doing. It has to be intentional. It cannot be merely tacit. The idea here is to arise mindfulness so that people will be intentional. And last but not least, and we'll see at least one example of this, it often happens when people are in the situation that they create new metaphors for themselves. And those new metaphors help them understand the situation and the learning. Now, writing studies, which is the field I'm in, also known as rhetoric and composition, has also been working on writing transfer. Especially been working on writing transfer, they or we, since the 2007 publication of a book called The Ends of Composition, which I think the title itself evoked a lot of response. People saw the ends of composition weren't altogether happy, so they worked very hard to create something about beyond the ends. De Palmer and Reamer, really working with ESL learners, English as a second language, non-native speakers, talk about transfer as being adaptive. Carol Hayes talks about it as being dynamic. Liz Wardle talks about it as repurposing. So that's in contrast to static transfer. And you're going to see an example of static transfer where someone is unable to recontextualize, unable to repurpose, unable to adapt. And when we think about a definition of transfer, this is one way of thinking about it, that what happens is a new context signals the potential for transfer. Now sometimes that new context, especially in the school environment, includes a teacher who provides that cue or provides that prompt. But where there's no one to provide that prompt, the context really should signal that, especially to the experienced writer. So it signals the potential for transfer, which we understand as an adaptive, dynamic process through which a writer repurposes what he or she knows and can do for a new task in that new situation and context. Now, the contribution that my colleagues and I have made, and I have several colleagues, the three of us, the three musketeers, as it were, Leanne Robertson, Kara Tozak, and yourself, that was the first iteration of the research. The second iteration of the research has two other colleagues, Matt Davis and Aaron Workman. And now we're moving into a third phase of the research that is at 9 sites across the United States, 3 community colleges, and then the rest are 4-year schools. I'm going to be referring here primarily to research at the first phase, but a little at the second as well. And we, in fact, being very interested in transfer, have created a curriculum for writing studies for entering college students, and now for upper level students as well, that we call the Teaching for Transfer curriculum. I'm going to show you a little bit about that in a minute, because that sets up the conditions for transfer while I spend most of the time. Basically, what happened in terms of exodus, what's the urgency, what's the occasion, why do we want to do this? Well, two things. We knew that writing process worked. In the United States, again, as we heard this morning, because it's also the case in Canada, faculty in all disciplines in higher education basically teach writing process. It doesn't always look the same, but they teach some elaborated version, and the research is absolutely clear. Students in the U.S. higher educational context develop an elaborated writing process, and they transfer it forward. They adjust it, they modify it, they sometimes shorten it, but we know that writing process works. So that's the good news. The bad news, but in the form of a question, is whether or not writing process is enough. And that leads to the second question, which you see here, which is whether or not students have enough conceptual knowledge. They have enough conceptual knowledge, but Anthony called declarative knowledge, to engage in successful transfer. And here's the kind of question. This is a student of mine 20 years ago who says to me, "It seems like every semester I take at least one cool class, and I get so pumped about the class, you know, really wanting to apply what I learned. But then I go into another class the next semester, and the teacher's saying exactly the opposite of what I learned last semester. And then I focus on the new class. It never seems to end." This is very common. This is very common. Some of you are laughing because you've seen it more than once. But my response to this is, I think that what the student is saying is completely accurate. If what the student means, and it happens to have been in England, what she means is that the expectations in the class she had been taking are different than the expectations of the class that she was then taking. It's absolutely right. But then my response is to say, she does not have a capacious enough theory of writing. If she had a theory of writing that was capacious enough, it would explain these differences. And that's what the TFT curriculum is supposed to help students develop. So the Teaching for Transfer curriculum has three major components to it. I'm going to give you one slide on each of them. Key terms. What are the key terms for writing? The key terms that build that conceptual knowledge. Second, a reflective curriculum. So systematic reflection built into the course, all the way through, built into the module. So that students at the end of the course, the end of the module, can write a theory of writing that enables them to frame new writing tasks in new writing situations. I will say as an aside, and I can talk about this more if you like during the Q&A, but this was developed and then we did try this again in a comparative study. There were two conventional kinds of writing modules and then the TFT. And the students in the TFT module outperformed the other students, no question whatsoever. And it's very interesting as to why. I'm happy to talk about that if you like. We have other research that actually has done the same thing, glad to look at that as well. So the key terms. These are the key terms we used. Rhetorical situation, which again, I think you heard a fair amount of rhetoric this morning, but basically rhetorical situation refers to purpose, to audience, to genre, to topic. The exigence is the occasion, or the urgency for writing. Audience, we heard about genre this morning. Reflection, the context for what we write. We talked about context and text this morning. Knowledge and purpose and discourse community. We also have a reflective curriculum that is systematic, so that students know that there's a rhythm to it, that there's a variety of tasks. They have to read about reflection so they understand the theory, and then they are practicing reflection. So it's fundamental to the enterprise. Then the last is a theory of writing, which students begin composing early in the term and then come back to it. It's an intricate process, and then that's what's called a reflection presentation at the end, where they articulate what their theory of writing is. And that theory of writing is what allows them to frame new writing tasks in new contexts. So those are the three signature pieces of the curriculum. And you can see that a fundamental part of it is not just reading theory and not just engaging with key terms, but drawing on their own writing practices in the course of the term, the last part at the end of the quote there. In other words, it asks students to create their theory of writing using the idea of their own made knowledge about writing and the idea of reflection as both theory and practice. So the idea is that they are making knowledge about writing as they engage in this particular module. Now I said before that Perkins and Solomon have five conditions for transfer, so no need to repeat those. What we found is that there are three conditions for transfer that are specific to writing, and that's where I'll focus the rest of my energy today, and I'll conclude by identifying five practices that we can use for teaching and three questions that can point the research forward. So the three are, and again, you can see them on your handout, that students have a rhetorical theory of writing that allows them to support transfer, that they are writing in contexts where they value writing, and where the writing that they're doing has a future. part, it's fundamental, and that's not just about writing, by the way. That's in the research literature more generally. And then that students are modifying that theory as they go forward, so-called conditionalizing. So, condition one, a rhetorical theory of writing through key terms. Borrowing from how people learn, you can see in the quote before you, that one difference, another difference, between novices' knowledge and experts is that novices' knowledge is much less likely to be organized around big ideas. Instead of big ideas, what novices have is a set procedure that they use over and over and over again. So if that's the case, and it's supported by the literature, and when you start taking a look at it, it kind of rings true, I might say intuitively. It raises the question as to what the key ideas ought to be. What are the big ideas? And those big ideas will have to be captured in language. So in the US context, these are the older terms for writing. They're all writing process terms. If you know anything about writing process, these are a little pretty familiar because these have been the terms that have been developed over time. They're wonderful terms, and we're not suggesting that they be abandoned. We are arguing that they are necessary, but they are not sufficient. And you've already seen the newer terms. I'll point out that in our research for entering college students, the terms that really seem to be salient to them are purpose. Purpose seems to be very important. Purpose seems to substitute for thesis or for claim. Purpose seems to be much more important than what's the purpose. And again, we've heard a lot about this today, but it is supported in our research. Genre is critical. And I'll say that the people who are looking at transfer writing studies, and there are some people who do that here, by the way, I'm not the only one. I'm looking at my peanut gallery friends up there, because they are engaging too, so you have a resource right here in Ireland. The writing transfer people who are looking at this are very sold on the idea of genre. There's no question, genre is very important. Some people talk about it basically as a portal into transfer. I think it's fundamental, but I will say that our research is showing that audience is at least as important, which actually links very nicely with what we've heard today, and you'll see some examples of that that I hope you'll find persuasive. As students move on in their college career, discourse community becomes very important, especially as they participate in their major, in their course of study. And then last but not least, they begin to understand how knowledge is made. Because knowledge is made in very different ways, in very different disciplines. So, to give you some examples of what students have said, to show how this works, key terms especially, that's where you want to focus your attention. This is a student of mine who talked about a multi-part, multi-series assignment that focused on World War I. And one of the exercises was a dialogue, and another was an expository piece of writing. And the student says, in writing the dialogue in the expository paper on World War II, I saw the effects of genre. The effects were very distinct because the topic of the papers was the control. No surprise, this is a science student, okay? So he saw it as a control of the variable. He is using, therefore, a metaphor of control to help him think about genre. Genre was the distinguishing feature. Very simple kind of example, but you can see how a piece of reflection helps him articulate to me, the teacher, for himself, what he's actually learned. To give you another example that's really closer to where we're trying to go, this comes from a student who is comparing work that he's done, again, in a first-year module in writing with a chemistry class that he's taking at the same time. So he's talking about what's the similarity and what's the difference between a research essay and a scientific poster. And you can see that he says, I have this poster I had to create for my chemistry class, which tells me what genre I have to use. And so I know how to write it, because a poster should be organized a certain way and look a certain way, and it's written to a specific audience in a scientific way. I wouldn't write the same way I would write a research essay. I'm presenting the key points about this chemistry project, not writing a lot of paragraphs that include what other people say about it or whatever, which is what we do in the humanities, by the way. So it's an accurate observation. The poster is just the highlights with illustrations, but it's right for its audience. That's what transfer looks like. Students are able to articulate both similarity and difference. And when you look at this and you begin to look at the key terms he uses, they are the key terms that come from the curriculum. Things like poster, which is a genre, essay, which is a genre itself, and so forth. So that gives you an example. I'll give you another example. We've talked here a little bit about assignments that all writers get. Sometimes the assignments are very elaborated, you have a pretty good idea of what's necessary. Other times, you know, you feel like you're walking in the dark. You don't really have any idea. This is a student who was in a psychology class. And as you're going to see, she was given an assignment that was focusing on personality disorders. And the problem for her that she had to face is that the assignment was very thin. Okay? This is a world in which thin is bad. This is the world I like living in, by the way, just saying. So, thin is bad. What she has to do is try to figure out what could be the context for this assignment, and this is what she says. And then I thought about my topic, which was borderline personality disorder, and who would care about it, and I kind of felt like I knew how to write this even before I started. I had an idea of how to make it happen. Anyway, the professor didn't really give us an audience. That might be a problem. So I thought about, obviously, him, the student. But also any students who might have had the disorder, or their family members, or whatever. So I had my audience, and my purpose, and then the genre was just essay. And also the context, which was the other part I always think about for writing. This was not just the class and the professor, but I was talking about all those people who take psych meds, and how doctors just prescribe them. We don't know if people really need them all, and it's just the drug companies, you know, selling the pills. So I thought about that too, for the context. She's imagining a context that allows her to have a purpose beyond just the assignment for the class. The research that Anthony referred to this morning about Flower and Hayes, doing early research and composing process, shows experienced writers, when they were given the kind of prompt that he mentioned, that's exactly the kind of process they went through, was trying to imagine a rhetorical situation in which they would be able to write. So we see her behaving very much like an experienced writer using the language of the TFT curriculum. Oh my goodness, look at that. I think I'll try something else now. That's what I love about it. So I'm going to get out of this and see if I'm doing that. Oh good, I'm so glad. Isn't it nice that it's a global PowerPoint?
Yeah.
Okay. So condition two. The future is now, or what Milton Hegel calls knowledge to go. And so the first reference there, which I think, and I didn't put here, but I'm happy to do, is Change Magazine. He and a colleague were basically outlining principles for transfer. And one of them is what he called knowledge to go, which I think is a very smart way of thinking about it. The idea is that if students think that there has some future purpose for anything that they're learning, the first thing that happens is their motivation goes up. And the second thing that doesn't always happen, but it can, is that the quality of the work goes up. So what that means is, and I will say, actually, as an aside, I'm not sure that we can always give students the purpose. Students look very different one to the next, unless I know them very well, I can't necessarily identify that, but I can invite them to think with me about what that future would be. And that's a very, very good thing to do. I've been in the fortunate position of working with several faculty at different institutions thinking about how we can enhance teaching and learning. And one of the items that comes up consistently is that ability to help students understand that the future is now. What are we doing now that will have relevance for the future? The second piece of research there is from Hilgers et al. It was a study that was done in 1999 at the University of Hawaii. They were interviewing senior students who were getting ready to graduate. And the senior students were very clear about appreciating the writing, especially at the upper levels, because they saw a purpose that connected that writing to their futures. Robertson and Tiller Burton did a research project at Oregon State where they asked students to identify at the beginning of a module what their goals for the course were and if those goals might include the future and what they would look like. They asked students to return to those goals midway, and they returned to them at the end. Again, the students' motivation went up and the quality of the work went up. The findings here are just perfectly consistent. The latest in this series is a project that's called the Meaningful Learning Project. Now been published as a book. This spring was published. It's a research study drawing from three institutions in the U.S., the University of Oklahoma, which is in Oklahoma, Northeastern, which is in Boston, and St. John's, who's in New York City. A very small N, okay, 700 students, so out of thousands and thousands, so no question it's a small N. That said, the patterns were very consistent. I can talk about this a lot as well afterwards. The salient point here is that there were three features that defined the writing that students at these three institutions wanted to be involved in it because it was so exciting to them. Also, they point out that this aligns perfectly with the Harvard Writing Study that was published in 2004. Same findings, where students' work intersects with the personal and the academic, the learning really takes off. In our case, building on these findings, what we have found, as you'll see, is that genre is very important, and audience especially is very important, but that this ability to transfer takes time and it takes participation. So thinking here about students valuing the context and seeing how it supports their writing future. And again, let me give you a couple of examples. This is actually a student in the first year, a student of mine, who begins talking about the role of audience and how that has really changed the student's understanding of writing. It's a he. Probably the biggest aspect I came to change and to improve in my writing was the realization and the understanding of the audience. I never used to pay attention to the audience I was writing to. I would just write my argument, pretty much ignoring everything else. In this class, we were taught to use invention to persuade. In order to use invention, all available means of persuasion for any given situation have to be understood. Our audience is a very important aspect to understand when persuading or arguing. For example, you wouldn't want to use slang or talk the same way you do to your friends if you were writing a letter to the president of a company or organization. And this, he says, relates back to a particular project that we engaged in, where we asked students to identify discourse communities that they participate in and how their language changed from discourse community to discourse community. So you can see that in accounting for this, he's going back to that early assignment and bringing that conceptual knowledge forward. This is because they were each directed to a politician. I didn't want to write to the general public, for example, all highway drivers or all American people, because these people can't do anything about the problem. I wrote specifically to politicians who can propose or pass a bill or vote to make a change. It's another aspect to all of my papers in that of English class. In this lab report, written this semester for my Engineering 120 class, I noticed myself constantly thinking about my audience. I would say to myself things like, would my professor want me to say this? Or would this wording be appropriate here? I took into account the way supporting graphs, as instructed by the professor, should go near the text that refer to them, which is not something we had addressed in class, just as well. So that's a case of transfer, where he's beginning to see, okay, this is going to affect other elements, and especially related to visual communication, as we've heard. The headers and most of the wording are also good examples of this. I wouldn't talk to most of my friends using the same words I did in this report. Good news, okay? It seems like a simple observation, but again, this is a case of reflection. If a student shares this with me or with a mentor, I can say, good call, keep doing that. Because one thing to know about learning is that it's important to show what students are doing well, not just what they're doing badly, and this is surely true for new employees as well. This is a first-year student that comes out of our study. First-year student who identified as a scientist, but is very clear about, again, the kind of language that she uses because the audience matters. She says, when I'm describing, so with my description of how the pathogen becomes, like, develops resistance to antibiotics, I talk about specific antibiotics, specific strains of the pathogen, and specific alleles and DNA strands, like very specific loci that the average person probably would not understand. I am your average person and I do not understand. You got that right. So discourse community in this situation, obviously, I'm not defining every single term that I use. If I were not speaking to this specific discourse community, for example, I probably would not have listed specific antibiotics, and I wouldn't have been as specific with listing alleles and stuff. So again, articulating her practice, why she's engaged in this, using the concept of discourse community to locate effective practice. And this is one that you all, especially given today's theme, may find to be very interesting. It's a student of mine actually from several years ago. As far as applying this to my job, and concurrent transfer here refers to the ability to work in two contexts simultaneously, which she's doing. She's taking a writing course with me, but as you'll see, she's also a tech writer. Well, that's an interesting question. So often we think of technical writing as being voiceless, but since this class, I've begun really to see the voice and lack of objectivity in technical writing. Actually, practicing technical writing has been a really wonderful complement to this class. That is an occasion for transfer, because I can relate so much of what I've learned to a field that is supposedly a sterile environment, free from all that we've been learning in this class. Everything I have learned about voice and about the multifaceted nature of stories, all price that is appropriate for my company, as we've heard, and I left out a lot of it because I didn't think it was important to the user. And notice how she's talking about the audience as the user. That is not the way we talk about audience, but she's modifying that understanding appropriately for the situation. I really think we all do this every day, but being more aware of it can only make us better writers and communicators. And you're going to see what we really think, what we're really finding in this research, is that students need situations like this, where they're working in contexts that are really very different, but they have conceptual knowledge that can bring them together so that they can see what's appropriate and what's not, what they should transfer and what they should not. So condition three, conditionalizing or modifying theories of writing. I've got a couple of examples here that do work in a couple of different ways. So the first example, that's going to sound pretty similar to what we just heard, comes from a student who is an interior design major. And she's explaining to the interviewer how these concepts work in her particular field. And she has expertise in it, even though she's a student, that we do not. And she says, it's a lot of genre and audience because you want your audience as your client. And they most likely will know what you're talking about in design terms. So I think it's important to have a very good idea of what you can and can't say to allow them to understand because they're the end user. And so if they don't understand, it's kind of pointless. And then I think each one of these things is a very specific genre because they're, you know, all specialized and used for different things. Again, the term audience becomes client, becomes end user, takes on a somewhat different cast. Then to be what we really think, is that learning takes place in what we're thinking of as two apprenticeships. And here we're borrowing from Ann Beaufort, who also borrowed from Alana Wenger around communities of practice. Hulin Ding has also done some interesting work in this area. And basically what they do is look at where people perform and where people learn. And they look at two, sort of generalizing, look at two contexts. The first they call a cognitive apprenticeship. Basically, a cognitive apprenticeship is very much like school. It's formal, it's organized, it's goal-directed, there's an expert, and the expert is helping the novices develop expertise. That's a cognitive apprentice, name your favorite module, because that's what you have. And that is in contrast to a social apprenticeship. The social apprenticeship is informal, it's peer-to-peer, it's more mentoring, and a lot of collaborative work. So that looks much more like the workplace, much more like internships, much more like co-curriculars, much more like service learning. And our theory is that social apprenticeships are so powerful, in part for three factors. Because students get to play different roles, because they see reciprocation between what they're learning in the social apprenticeship and what they're learning in the cognitive apprenticeship, and that reciprocation empowers or basically animates the learning, and also that there's more reiteration in the social apprenticeships than there seems to be in the cognitive. The cognitive apprenticeships seem to be much more progressive, and there's less returning to learn. And just the nature of the work in social apprenticeships seems to be more iterative. So let me show you a couple of examples. It would be better if I went forward to show you those. Let me see if I can manage that. Oh, that's good. Okay. So I'm going to give you an example of a social apprenticeship that we have at my place. This is a museum of everyday life, writing. It has letters, diaries, postcards, recipe books, tattoos, writing in the bathroom, you name it. It's all everyday writing. Not in the workplace and not in school. It's created by two graduate students. One's now finished, Megan Keaton. The other's on her way to finish, Jennifer Enid. And what we've done for a year and a half now is invite undergraduate research interns to come in and work in this museum. And when you look at it, it's very interesting because of the kinds of roles that they have to play. And it's all team-based. And we interview them. And if they don't want to work in teams, then we don't ask them to join us. And the good news is we have more applicants than we have spaces. We ask the undergraduate interns to write to contributors so that we can have more contributions, to work on social media. We have Facebook, we have Twitter, we have blog. We're totally 21st century. We host face-to-face events, so we have them totally online. They upload artifacts. They curate exhibits. And please, by all means, please go there. You just Google Museum of Everyday Writing, it'll take you right there. So this gives you some idea of the multiple roles and the kind of authority that students have in this kind of situation. It's a pretty good model of a social apprenticeship. Let me give you another example of what this looks like there. This is a particular student at Florida State who is a marketing major, as you're going to see. And her particular co-worker is leading a Bible study group, and it is sponsored in part by FSU, as it is an accepted student organization. And she says, her name is Jim, "This semester, my writing heavily involved tailoring what I wrote to many different audiences. I co-lead a Bible study, and that contains 3 to 4 levels of audience writing, including Bible study notes for myself, Bible study notes I share with my co-leaders, and questions tailored to different girls with newer and deeper faith." And then she was looking for money from the university to sponsor a particular charity event that's called Box of Love. And she talks about what's the best way to make the pitch so that she can get the funding that she wants, which is a sort of corporate communication question. And she sees that because she's a marketing major. As she says, she's initially composing the Microsoft Word, but then she says, "I have this very long document for like itty bitty words." And I'm like, okay, this format would fit so much better in a PowerPoint. And that reminded me in how a lot of corporate or business situations, when you're presenting an idea or pitching a product, you do it in a PowerPoint in front of a room with a board member. It helped me compartmentalize, the way I was thinking, is what she says, and why I thought that was a good idea, and how we would implement it and everything. And so that format just fit what I needed to present in a really good way. You can see the reciprocity between both. She's able to get ideas and use them in the social apprenticeship, then she takes the social apprenticeship and brings that back to class. I'll give you another example here that looks at really the issue of time and the salience of audience in a social apprenticeship where someone's applying for an internship. This particular student says, as you can see, "Unlike websites and papers on topics I enjoy writing about, I found writing my resume, which we required him to do in the class that I helped teach, to be dreadfully boring," thank you very much, "and uninteresting. Consequently, I can honestly say," sometimes I wish they would not honestly say, but okay, "I can honestly say that I just threw my paper together without much thought." Oh, good. "However, later in the year, I found myself having to assemble a real resume for several internship opportunities. I went back to the resume I created for the first paper and realized that, rhetorically speaking," aha, finally, "it was not suited for the position I was looking for. So I went back to it and redesigned it, this time using my enhanced understanding of rhetoric to make a better argument." As you can see, and he shared his version of the resume, "this version of my resume is far more visually appealing and better organized." Because why? He wants a social apprenticeship. To an employer looking for interns, and notice how he has now adopted the position of his audience. To an employer looking for interns, this resume not only fits the job description better, but the added visuals dramatically increase my ethos and hints at other talents in addition to the program. This is a student who's beginning to understand writing as doing something, as being rhetorical, because he's looking to interface his cognitive apprenticeship with his social apprenticeship. Last but not least, I'll give you an example, and I will show you, this is also not, I have no magic bullet, as it were, and I'll show you an example where it didn't work. This is a very interesting case because it's a mature student who's done some work experience, he's come back to school, and he leaves school and does work experience, eventually I hope he gets through, but he brings from the social apprenticeship what he's learned about writing to school. And here's what he says. "Part of my secondary education was finishing my architect's associate for drafting. So I used to think of things on paper in blocks and chunks, and I would move them around like that. And eventually, when I was doing more projects and keeping schedules, that is for other people, what I do is draw blocks out on a paper, and they'll go down the left-hand side, say from top to bottom, and then next to that block is the information of that project. And I think eventually, I suppose, in a way that's sort of a bullet point, I see it parsed out. When I'm thinking about writing 5 pages, I will visualize, okay, what's the first 3/4 of the page supposed to look like? And the bottom quarter into the full second page, what's that going to look like? So again, it visually parses out like that, and that actually helps me establish the rhythm of the paper and where the idea is going to be presented. How do they segue into one another? Then I'm not so worried." This brings up another point, where students have more conceptual knowledge, where they can articulate this, where they think they have a future, the research shows they have much more confidence. So this is important in terms of helping people develop the confidence that they need as they move into their writing contexts. I did promise that nothing is perfect, as we this research, which was published about 3 years ago, she had 2,500 reviews of books. So this is a pretty serious effort. And that's the way she understands a literature review. But she was asked to do a literature review as part of a research project, which is very different. And she didn't change it. What she did was basically do a literature review where she recommended certain articles. That's not the way it works. That's static, right, sir. That's not dynamic. So it can happen. And we need to think about what we can do so that it doesn't happen. Let me say more generally, as I'm beginning to close, that we think a model of writing development looks less like this. I'm able to critique this because it's my graph. So I can have as much fun with it as I like. You'll notice if you look at the graph that the most important element in this model of writing development, which is signaled to you by where it is on the slide, by its size, is classes. And we provide for lots of other sites, writing centers, internships, co-creators, and so forth, but classes really tell the tale in this model. And based on our research, we're pretty certain that this is not the way it works, at least today. The way it works today looks more like this. The student is at the center, the student is a node in a very complex network, and has any number of sites in which he or she may be writing. And for one student, it might look like this, where classes are fundamental and co-creators are fundamental. But for the next student, it might be the classes are fundamental, that the writing center is fundamental, that the workplace is fundamental, and that reciprocity is really the way forward. So one of the things we're trying to take a look at as we go forward is what other models are there, and are some models better than others in terms of supporting writing knowledge and practice. So I promise, what does this mean for teaching, at least a little bit, and what does it mean in terms of research? So for teaching, our recommendation would be that we ask students what they can bring forward and how they can use what they're learning about writing, that is the conceptual knowledge, or how people learn calls for big ideas, as well as about how to write, that is the processes. They need both. Second, that we identify those big writing ideas and have students work with them. You can't simply have them memorize the terms. That won't work. They've got to use them to describe what it is that they're engaging in terms of writing tasks. Third, that we ask students to compose in twos. Two genres, two audiences, two media, because those twos set up a set of contrasts that allow you to say, like the chemistry student did, what's the similarity, what's the difference, right? Fourth, ask students what they have learned, that is, to reflect in such composing. And we think, actually, that students ought to share some of that learning so that the communities that they're part of have the benefit of learning with the students and sharing with them as well. And then last but not least, we think that we should all be designing for reiterative practice. So reiteration, roles, and reciprocities. As to going forward with research, there is still good news, much to do. First of all, about the rhetorical theory. We've done a lot of work with this particular curriculum, as I've indicated now. Basically, even the new sites have all engaged in a pilot, and they all presented on it at a conference in the spring. So we have, at this point, well over 1,000 students, and we're creating a pretty nice database of what we've learned. I will say that the uptake of the curriculum, that is the way the students have taken up the curriculum and what they've done with it, it's not 100%. I'm not sure that any curriculum would ever be 100%. It's a human world, and so how you ever get to 100% is a very interesting sort of epistemological and philosophical question. But it could be better than it is. And we need to find out why it's not working as well as it could. And my own sense, for what it's worth, is that we need to focus better on the students for whom it didn't work and try to tease out why it's not working. Second has to do with the second condition, which is a future. How do we help students imagine possible futures? So I'll give you a good example. I had a student very early on in my teaching career. He told me that he wasn't altogether happy to be in my writing class because he was going to be a dentist and have his secretary do all the writing for him. This was before he took biology and failed it. And your teeth are safe. Okay. But it does mean that he was so narrowly focused on a particular future that he didn't understand what was possible. This was actually a conversation we were having at lunch with some of us. So how do you imagine a more capacious future? how can we learn to help students think in those terms? And then last but not least, questions about conditionalizing and modifying. How do we help students understand the time needed to develop as writers, that people do develop as writers, that it's not you come in and take a module and we're done, that it's a much longer, and in fact, the bad news is, or the good news, depending on the perspective, I think students would see it as bad news, is that writing is in fact a lifelong process. I am still learning to write new genres. I was a co-PI on a grant right now that's with the National Science Foundation, and I've actually done, I was a co-PI once before, but the good news then is I didn't have to write the grant. This time, the person leading the grant is a wonderful person, and it's a good thing because I needed something wonderful. And, you know, he wanted me to help learn it. And I've written grants before, but not that one. And I mean, it's just, you have to sign up for NSF Fastlane. There's just all this stuff that comes along with it. And I'm not as young as you think I am. So, just saying, we're all learning. So, time we need to develop as writers. Second, how do we help students participate in both cognitive and social apprenticeships? The students we see, a lot of them, are engaging in writing that in some way or another would be identified as a social apprenticeship. It may be we need to bring that language in, help them understand how that works, and then try to trace a little reciprocity. And then last but not least, of course, reflect meaningful on that. Thank you very much. You've been very terrible.
Transfer.
Uh-huh.
And I just wondered, is that one module, or would you see it as like working across an entire program?
That's a great question. It started out as a single module.
Okay.
And in the second iteration, it became a module at an upper level. So a technical writing class or a professional writing class in the junior level. In this next iteration, one of my parts of this project is to work with interns and to bring something up that TFT curriculum to mention. So, and I will also say, for reasons that I genuinely do not understand, we've had a lot of interest in the TFT curriculum from a small liberal arts kinds of colleges where there is no living writing studies. So faculty across the curriculum teach writing and incorporate writing into their modules, and they're very, very interested. And I find it sort of curious. In some ways, I'm more interested in it than writing studies before. And I think it's partly because we've tried to do a good job of looking at how writing really does work across the university. And so people can read themselves into it. It's a lovely question.
I think I'm one of those faculty, but my frustration is that it's all so fragmented. I'm limited to what I can achieve in my module.
Yeah.
And I recognize here that, you know, for that purpose,
yes,
for the student to develop their sense of purpose, it's like as if it needs to be more connected across their program.
I think that's exactly right. And a very good question is how we can find out.
Yeah.
And with willing people like you, it's fine.
I'll be on the blog.
Go on the blog, send me an email.
Together with Alison, our peanut buddies up here in the corner, we wondered how could we get Kathleen here. So
and the answer was just